All right. Well, it's update time. We are over here at the local Jack in the Box. We had us a nice dollar chicken sandwich with some extra mayo, barbecue sauce. Now, we're going to talk a little bit about private maritime law again. Now, I went to the laundromat the other day, and because of the lane that I've put in, the local Four Square Church, which is a church that I used to attend, one of the churches that I used to attend up in Washington State. And some things went down there that were a little bit unfavorable to my side in the short run, but it was for my learning, for the favorable side in the long run. But because of what happened, the commercial lane that I finally put in here some 10 years later has caused the Four Square Church to render my situation to have laundry facilities, not only for me, but for the whole community. That's the power of the commercial lane. When you see the tree bend, you know the wind's blowing. Now, these are signs from Mother Nature. A tree is part of Mother Nature. The wind's part of Mother Nature. All of this stuff that we see that's been manifested in the corporate world, all these buildings and machines that we have, are all part of manufactured manifestations. In my study of natural law and meditation and the study of the brain, the upper brain, the lower brain, we learn how to listen to Mother Nature, her communication. And she speaks through two processes that I've found so far. One is using nature itself, as in the trees and the animals, and people. The atmosphere, the wind, the sun, the moon, the clouds. And the second way that she communicates is through manufactured signs. For instance, car horns, sirens, train horns, music. Doors closing and opening, cars revving, motorcycles revving, traffic noise. These are some of the manufactured sounds that are manufactured from the real thing, which is Mother Nature. Now, what I found in my practice and the studies of yogis is that when we sit in the backyard and we learn how to watch our thoughts, I found this out with the help of cannabis, which allowed me to slow down my thought process so that I can actually keep up with what's going on. Because thoughts travel very fast sometimes. And the cannabis, like I said, slowed my thoughts down. So once my thoughts were slowed down, I was able to start to see a synchronization. The word synchronization just means they happen at the same time or shortly thereafter. But there is a connection. And what I found is that when we have particular thoughts, there is a sometimes there is a signs from Mother Nature to either give us confirmation of our thoughts or to give us warning of our thoughts. And the way that we know whether it's confirming or it's a warning, that's just another way of saying on the positive side of the spectrum and on the negative side of the spectrum. The way we know this is using our heart as the actual mechanism to tell us whether or not our thoughts are right on as far as confirmation as a truth, or it's a warning of things that we need to work on. Because remember, all of life is about self improvement, self regulation. This is called alchemy. And when you learn to listen to Mother Nature, who is a manifestation of Father Thought, known as Father Cause. Some call him God, some call him Buddha, Allah, Muhammad, Jesus, whatever you want to call him. Father Thought manifests things into existence. And one of the things that Father Thought manifests into existence is these things called signs from Mother Nature. And let's backtrack a little bit back, though, to the manifestation of these thoughts or through signs and using our heart to regulate whether it's telling us it's a confirmation in the positive or it's a confirmation in the negative, meaning an attaboy or a warning. Now, when we use our heart, all our heart is our conscience. It's the Most High. The Most High is called the cerebrum. It's the highest part of our skull, our brain. And in the Most High, we have it represented in the Bible, in the Old Testament, as the temple. Outside the temple is the courtyard. And that represents the lower brain. Inside the temple is the Most High. This is the upper brain. And this temple, inside the temple, the Old Testament, when you do your studies, it has what's called an outer room and an inner room, separated by a veil. And behind the veil is the Ark of the Covenant. And this is where the Holy of Holies is. This is your upper brain, your Most High. It's your conscience. It's the thing that you're using that keeps you driving behind the steering wheel every day, that you use to talk with. It's the forefront of your awareness. We've all heard these terms all the time, you know, even to the point of my conscience was getting to me, so I couldn't pull the trigger and kill my brother. so to speak, as an example. Extreme sense of conscience, but very needful. Now, this upper brain, known as the cerebrum, has a male and a female side. In your laws of the universe, everything has a male and female side. It's known as the law of gender. If you want to learn about the laws of gender or the laws of the universe, there is a book you can get that was written in 2012 called The Kabbalion by the Three Initiates. And it'll teach you the seven fundamentals of the seven fundamental laws of the universe. How this universe operates. Now, one of the laws that's not in there that is very important is called the law of agreement. And this is all comes down to the legal system that we live in surrounding the birth certificate application bond that is agreed to through assumption on the private attorney's part, fraud out of the need of necessity, though, and of course, rebutting that assumption by way of an actual real affidavit of truth known as a CAT, commercial affidavit of truth. Now, like I said, all you gotta do is get the book and read it, you'll learn about the laws. So, remember, your upper brain has a male and a female side. This corresponds with the law of gender. Your lower brain also has a male and a female side. And you can kind of get a gist for this from the book called The Golden Flower. It's basically a book on Chinese religions. Buddhism and Taoism and maybe some other names in there that aren't to my memory right now. But you'll start to learn about the subconscious, which for the most part in mankind is regulated by the lower brain called the cerebellum. So the upper brain is called the cerebrum. The lower brain is called the cerebellum. So remember Sarah, who was Isaac's wife, or was it Abraham's wife? Yeah. Abraham had a wife named Sarah, and she had two sons, Isaac and Ishmael. No. Jacob and Ishmael. Whoa, wait a second here. Isaac, I think it was, yeah. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, yeah. Yeah, Sarah had two sons. The first son, though, represents the lower brain, which is Ishmael. Ishmael's the female side. This is the Eastern side of religion. This is where this all rooted from began. And Sarah also gave birth to the upper brain, which is represented to the son of promise, the son of regulation, the son of enforcement on the earth, prison planet, control, where tribe of Judah came out of King David, King Solomon, and all the ancient secrets that were passed down from Atlantis, and before that from the caveman coming up through Egypt, and therefore into the tribes of Israel from Adam through Noah, and so forth and so forth. The upper brain represents, like I said, Isaac, and he is the Western side of religion. He represents the male side. So Ishmael represents the female side. Isaac represents the male side. The male side is the conscience. And the female side is the subconscious. It's your instinct. It's your impulse. It's that part that you don't use thought for. And I'll give you an example. When a mother has cubs, and another animal comes around close to her and her cubs, and she feels that animal might be a threat, she don't think about it. It's instinct, impulse. And in that impulse, there's a male and a female side. The male side is the more thoughtful side, and that is the rescue side. When you go to rescue someone in a car that's crashed and it's a fire life situation, you don't think about it. You just get right in there and you rescue the person on impulse. Most people do. Well, not most people, but some people do, some people don't. Let's just put it that way. That way there's no blame on anybody. Now, that's the male side of the female brain, which is the impulse. Now, the female side of the female brain is the impulse to violence. This is where, if you look at someone the wrong way, they don't like it. This was the killer Kilby world that ruled in the jungle. The female side of the brain, the double negative. The negative of averment. Think about those things and make the connection. That was a Veda. That just came to me just now. If you understand what Vedas are, they're thoughts that just automatically just come improvised from the spirit. So even as I say that, I got to make the connection. But I see it. It's in the spirit. A double negative, because I've heard that in commercial law, private maritime law. You've got to send a negative averment to the opposing party for them to prove that there's actually a debt on the record and that they didn't actually borrow money or take money from the birth certificate application bond, which you have backed. All of us has backed. All of our fathers. So, getting back to the female side of the brain, the double negative. It's the impulse to violence. And this is what King David ruled the earth with, the impulse to violence. It was, you mess with me, I'm going to cut your head off. Point blank. And yes, I'm an actor. And I have some excellent acting skills. And I could get downright mean and nasty sounding and looking. You know about that TV show a long time ago. It used to be called Scared Straight. And there's videos on it. You just type in Beyond Scared Straight. And you'll see the prisoners come out to the young boys and the young girls and get right in their face. And they will reveal to you what the female side, the female side, known as the double negative side of the brain, the impulse, is like. It is, I will take you the fuck out, you fucking motherfucker. Who the fuck you looking at? You better turn your motherfucking eyes, get your tail between your legs, because I'm about to take you out. You better submit to me. That's what it is. It's either submit to me with your tail between the leg. It's total terrorism. It's intimidation at its fullest. It's the strong survive. And you know what that is. But that's what Prison Planet started out with. It inherited that from the Killer Kill Bee world of the jungle. And it had to be filtered down. And it had to be modified. And mankind had to be rehabbed from that female side to graduate to the female, to that more of a rescue side, I'm going to rescue you through impulse, to over to the male side. And there's a female side of the male side and a male side of the male side. And so I got to do more studies to get personalized and acquainted with that, but it'll come. Today's studies were on the female side, or the female side, the male and the female side of the female brain. Just came crystal clear to me, because I do my own private radio station in the backyard with no power, no cable. I use Tesla radio wave systems. It's just live. Words put into the air, whoever can hear, neighbors and whatnot. And yes, I do talk to my neighbors to make sure that they don't think that I'm some crazy whack. And that I'm not too loud. I ask them, am I being too loud? This, and that. So, me and my neighbors are all right. And I got a bike path behind my yard, so I got public access to introduce myself to the public little bit by little bit. It's just perfect for me because I am going international with all this information. I am the Jesus of this mind shift. that we're going into, and I ain't dying. And I explained that in the last video. It has to do with the claim of lien. When you understand fully what that claim of lien can do, you understand that nothing can collect from you. That includes sickness, illness, tragedy, accidents, nothing. Nothing can harm you. Nothing can collect from your, nobody can collect from your body. That includes harm. Point blank. But you gotta walk in it. You gotta keep yourself reminded in it. You gotta understand it. That's why the Proverbs Solomon wrote, understanding and wisdom is the key to life. So, now, when you're dealing with the female side of the brain, you're dealing with what's called black magic. When you're dealing with the male female side of the brain, you're dealing with white magic. It's a diluted form of white magic. The fullness of white magic is all the way over on the male side, on the western side. Remember, Isaac was the blessed child. Ishmael was also blessed, but he was rejected because he was not the chosen promised child to rule the earth, to bring people out of the jungle into the rehab centers under legal codes and statutes to teach everybody how to be peaceful and safe. And that's the basis of private maritime law. It's peace and safety. Not to mention the security agreement and the claim of lien. Some people call it being a secure party creditor. Now, you're not going to get your eternal life until you actually fully utilize that claim of lien. That means that you're not paying anybody anything. All your bills are non-collectible. So if you're paying rent and using cash in life, your lien is still good. You can still do certain things with it in the legal realm. But in the lawful realm, that has to do with your eternal life, you ain't there yet. That's just point blank. And I want to put that out there so that you have motivation to start taking the next steps when you're ready. There's no rush. There's no hurry. Because I am going to be here forever. I ain't going anywhere. I'll always be here to guide you up until your last dying day under legal codes. Because you're not fully out of legal codes if you're still paying cash to somebody. Let that sink in. Don't be ashamed of it. And don't cry and don't get all worried. Please don't get offended. But that's the honest God's truth. And you'll learn these things when you sit down with your brain, see how it works, and learn the communication of Mother Nature to send you signs to confirm everything. So, the female side has to do with black magic. Black magic is just universal laws that a long time ago mankind used to know, and they took universal law to the negative side to manipulate people, intimidate people under their control. I'll give you an example of a real life example of black magic being used. And I'll give you a real example from my situation, because now's the time to say, see this nose right here? You notice that it's broken. I'm going to tell you how it got broken. Mother Nature had to teach me a lesson. When I put my commercial lien in, a couple years later, I went down to the free food place and got me some free food. That was a nice chicken dinner. And they had a new skateboard bicycle park put in with those deep pool looking things where you go up and go up the thing and you can come down it with your skateboard, or you can do the same thing on your bikes. Massive one, $2 million project put right in our town underneath the freeway overpass where all the homeless used to hang out. And so I went there, and I says, wow, I want to try this out. This is cool. I never tried it out before. So I tried it out, but I ended up going too fast. And I was going to the park way too fast. I was being unsafe. And in fact, I was pissing the kids off. They was giving me mean looks. I eventually got off my bike, and I decided just to slide down with my body into the pit and practice my falls. Well, that was too much for one of the kids to handle. And he got up in my face, long-haired tattoo, blonde-haired kid, and he says, get out of the park. And I just looked at him, and I kind of said, I think I said, why? And he didn't have an answer. And so I just did a backflip, not a flip, but I just fell backwards because I was on the edge of the pool. And I went down and slid down and said, ah, got back up again, went up, and I did it again right in front of him. Ah. And by this time, someone looked up at me, one of the other kids, and he says, where's your bike, man? So I went back up there. Someone stole my bike. No big deal. The law of the universe is going to come back to me. Put your thoughts on it. It ain't stolen. It's just Mother Nature took it, and she's going to return it. But a couple days later, I was going to the store to get some goods, get some candy, coming back home. And also at that time when I was at the candy store, I decided to try some different stuff because you could check out some candy through the self-checkout lines, and you put the candy on the weigh scale yourself. So I was trying to try some things out. See if I could get away with not having to pay as much because I know my lean is good. All that stuff's actually free. So I was just trying some stuff out with my conscience. But actually that night, I put some chocolate on for the second time, and it was the final time I decided I was going to do it. The first time I did it, I put some chocolate on, and it only rang up to 10 cents, so I just put a dime in it. Right there in front of everybody. Witnesses and everything. Nobody said anything. Just walked out. Second time I did it, I had about 70 cents worth of candy, and the lady kind of caught me this time, but it all looked legitimate because what I was actually doing is holding the bag a little bit with my hand, so it didn't weigh as much. So needless to say, I paid up, put my quarters in, I went home, and it was dark. This is my usual thing. I would go out in the dark at night, the bike path, no problem. I didn't have any fears. I have no friends. I don't talk to anybody, you know. No one disrespects me, except something was starting to rise because I would go down to the free speech zone and start raising my voice. Start talking about the sin that I used to preach, and I started talking about the commercial lean, loud and clear. I'm walking through the town on the sidewalk, started singing too about the commercial lean. Well, next day one of the kids didn't like it, and a group of them passed me by and said, fuck off, as they drove by me real quick, took off. But anyway, getting back to the story, I was riding my bike home that night, and one of the kids played drunk, cut me off in the bike path. Didn't really cut me off, he just kind of swerved in because we were going opposite directions. I was going this way, he's walking this way, and he walked right in front of me just before I got to him. So I stopped. He looked at me and he says, hey, you want to buy some weed? I said, what do you got? He said, like $7 a gram. I says, well, I'll think about it. Then he changed his mind, and he said, hey, I got some weed right now. You want to go smoke some? I said, all right. So I went over there, and by this time, another kid walked up, and he hands me a cigarette. You want a cigarette? And handed the other guy a cigarette, and then he pretended to light the other guy's cigarette. You know, it was like they didn't know each other. It's like some dudes off the street, hey, you want to smoke some weed too? Okay. So we're at the bike path. Now we're in the bike path happens to go through the back of a elementary school, and then there's neighbors on the other side, and it's a power line stretch of grass too, and it just goes for a couple miles, 2 or 3 miles like that. So he reaches over to light his friend's guy who was playing drunk, a little bit drunk and tipsy. These are young boys in their teens, maybe 20 or so, maybe a little over, and so he reaches over to light the other guy, his friend's cigarette, and the guy kept playing drunk and falling backwards, and I just kept looking straight, and they were there. I figured they're just gonna light it and show back up in front of me. Next thing you know, boom, One of them hit me in the head as hard as he could. Bam! And I had recollections of one time. Also, I had already been hit on that side of the head before from another crowd when I was fresh out of the military. When I was 20, I went up to as a high school crowd. And one of the guys, for some reason, didn't like me. So he started wanting to pick a fight with me. And then I got kind of angry, and I said to the whole crowd, I said, "Hey, man, why are you guys treating me like this?" And someone just jumped out of the crowd and just nailed me on the side of the head, right in the ear. Bam! So I just kind of held my head and just took off, rode on home slowly, considered it a loss and a lesson. But anyway, I got hit on the head again, so it wasn't a surprise to me. I had been hit there before, and I just turned around. I looked at him. I says, "Why did you do that?" Because they were expecting me to fall down and get knocked out. I had already been hit there before, and my instant reflex was, "Oh, I know what that was." And they hit me as hard as they could. And the dude who was playing drunk, all of a sudden, he dropped a bottle out of his jacket because he was stunned that I was still standing. He was scared shitless for a fraction of a second. Until I decided to go backwards and I said, "Well, these two dudes want to fight and they're going to chase me down." And I'm not a fighting man. So I just put the bike down. And they ended up beating the shit out of my head. I just put my hands up, and there was a third guy too, so it was 3-on-1. So all I did was hit my head, bam, 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 from the back and the front. They had guys in the back and the front. I got hit about probably 16 times, or no, about 12 times, 4 times from each of them, till I slipped on the ground, and two of them came at me. And the other third guy just kind of backed off a little bit because he was more of the watch. Second guy came up, or the two guys jumped me when I slipped on the ground. And at that point, one of them got me in the headlock, and I knew he was kind of unskilled at doing this, and he wasn't very strong. But the other guy was, you know, the other two guys were bigger than me, taller, slender guys, though, still. But the guy who was playing drunk was a kind of like an Indian-looking dude. He was smaller. He's kind of like the brains of the bunch, you could say. Kind of like the bully brain of the bunch. But he went to try to get me in a headlock. And the other guy came up beside me, punched me in the side, on the shoulder. And I had managed to at least get to my knee a little bit while I was still on the ground. And then when I finally got my footing, the power and the strength just came in me. And I just shoved him off me. And I was broke free. By this time, I guess some witness must have been coming down the bike path, and they decided to split up and go. But the little Indian-looking guy, he says, "Give me your money, give me your weed." And I says, "I ain't got no weed, I ain't got no money." But anyway, also when they first started hitting me, I asked him, I says, "Why are you doing this? Why are you doing this?" And the little guy, all he could say was screaming frantically. He was kind of scared while he was saying it, kind of frantic. All he could say was, "We're the mob, the mob, the mob." So I got introduced to the public mob. All because, and I went home and I started thinking about it. And they couldn't get my bike this time because the fender got caught in the back wheel. And I actually tried to do an escape, but my fender was caught in the back wheel. And so I just put the bike down and slowly turned back toward them. And just, you know, my sense was just to take the beating. Something inside me said, you know, I did something wrong. What I did was I broke my peace treaty. And Mother Nature sent the mob after me. I learned about the mob. All the mob is just a local gang. Or just the local kids who enforce, you know, people that doing unsafe things. So I learned a lesson. But there's another side of the story that, in a way, they were wrong. I can explain that later. But that's how my nose was broken. And, so, for some reason I told you that story. Now, what was it? Why was I going to tell you? I guess maybe it had to do with breaking your treaty, breaking your peace. let's just put it at that. A change of subject. I got a little lost here where I was, but that happens. But I'm going to tell you, if you got a commercial lien and you break your peace treaty, like I did, I was being unpeaceful. I admit it. I went home and I thought about it, and I instantly thought, oh, shit. In their eyes, I was being unpeaceful. Okay, in their eyes. Now, on a universal level, it's a little bit different. Because on their part, no one got harmed. No one got injured on their part. So they struck me illegally. But lawfully, Mother Nature is the one that did it. Mother Nature used them to teach me a lesson, to open my eyes that, yes, there is a mob out there, and yes, I was being unpeaceful according to legal rules. Now, according to lawful rules, there are no legal rules. And it's just a matter of if someone gets offended or not. But racing around on the bike track, or the pool or the skateboard track. It was a combination pool, skateboard track. Racing around and just having fun. Because I was. I was just having fun. Never did it before. But I was going too fast for them. And I could tell I was going too fast for myself. Because I could feel my adrenaline rush was a little overboard. So Mother was letting me know you need to control your adrenaline rushes. But still, I was having a good time, man. I was like, yeah, this is cool, man. Doing my thing. But I could tell it was pissing people off. Because I would just stop real quick in front of them before any crash happened. I'd stop to crash. You know, or I'd swerve away from them, whatever it took. You know, I was fully alert, man. I was having a good time. Remember, I just had a big chicken dinner, free. Nice chicken dinner at the free food place. Tasty, full of energy. Yeah, new bark park. Never done this before, even as a kid. Always wanted to do this. Wham, I went out there, man. It was cool. Had a good old time. But, like I said, it was too much for them to handle. And on my part, it was being unsafe. If it was too much for them to handle, I was being unsafe. So, Mother Nature taught me an instant lesson about breaking their peace treaties. It's the one thing that, if you do, now Mother Nature or the corporation has a cause to take you down and teach you a lesson. Take you aside. It's the same thing. If you got a commercial lien, security agreement, and commercial lien, which is an international peace treaty at the highest level that's backed by the Hague and the international military at the top and the universal postal unit. Think about these things. But if you break your peace treaty, such as, I'll give you an example, a corporate example, a real corporate example, drinking too much, getting in your car and swerving around on the freeway and causing havoc on the freeway, you're going to get pulled over. And the cop is going to mandatorily test you. Regardless if you got a lien or not, probably. And if you do got a lien and you know how to use it, and if you're wise and know how to use your words, then you'll ask for his attorney, or you'll ask for a sheriff at the scene, or you'll ask for a U.S. Marshal at the scene. And you'll have some heavy explaining to do. And they'll probably recommend that you call a tow truck, tow your car home, or leave it there and pick it up the next day and get a cab. Or depending on your attitude, if you're coming from the female side of the brain, which is the violent side of the brain, you give them a bunch of shit and a hard time, they're going to cuff you, take you in, or at least put you in the car. And they have lawful right. I'm saying lawful. Because you're breaking the peace. Think about these things very carefully. I had to learn the hard way. That's the way I am. On a lot of things. Some things I don't learn easily, but I had to learn that one the hard way. And I was willing to do it anyway. In my spirit, I knew within me that I'm willing to go through whatever it takes to get to the other side. That's just who I am. I got no qualms going through what I have to get to the other side. I do like to do things peacefully and the good way, the easy learning way, but sometimes, like I said, the animal brain takes over. And that's the female side of the brain. That's the non-thinking part. Right? Now, if you get a combination of your conscience and the female brain toward violence, now that's called premeditation. Now you've planned things out for violence. And that is a little more tough on than impulse violence. Instinct impulse. That's why people plead insanity, because they're like, damn, I just came out of me. But premeditated, you get found guilty for premeditated, oh boy. You knew exactly what was going on. You made a conscious decision from your holy of holiest female side of your brain. So there it is. We got a revelation on the male side of the brain, the female side. It's that side that premeditates. There it is. We just got the revelation. That's a Veda right now. And then, of course, the male-male side of the brain would be the thinking side for rescue. The male-male side of the brain is what created all this manufactured goods, all these cities and the rules and the regulations that Moses came up with. Even before that, Moses learned these from Egypt. He was a student of the Egyptian schools before he went back to rescue his Hebrew brothers and sisters. And Egypt learned it from Atlantis. And Atlantis learned it from the Indians, especially the private side of the Indians known as the Iroquois Indians, which are the same Indians that occupied the land around New York State and a couple states around there, where when the settlers came over here and they took out all the Indians, there was one group of Indians they couldn't defeat called the Iroquois. And so, because they couldn't defeat the Iroquois, they went into a peace treaty with the Iroquois. This is what opponents do. If you can't defeat your opponent and you find, you know, that they're strong as you, or stronger, the second best thing to do is to go into peace treaty with them. And that's what happened. The colonists went into peace treaty with the Iroquois Indians. And in fact, the American Constitution was patterned after the Iroquois Indians system. Now, after generations have passed, and the originals, Iroquois, and the original settlers that made that contract and the Constitution and that peace treaty, the children, through the generations, broke that peace treaty with the Iroquois, and now finally the Iroquois were brought into the prison system of citizenship. That had to happen, because everybody has to go through prison rehab, prison planet rehab system from the Killer Kilby world jungle. They had to become citizens, and that's a good thing, because now you can operate in bankruptcy and eventually back your currency with the people. And when the people start to realize that fraud is done out of necessity, and all this HR 192 in the United States, all debts are canceled, both past and future, was done out of necessity, out of behind the people's backs, wasn't told to the common people because they weren't smart enough and ready to handle the truth, otherwise they would have rioted. So it had to be done behind secret. So everything had to be done in fraud. Had to be. That's why you cannot get mad at anybody, any bankers, for operating fraud. You cannot point the finger, because this all comes straight from Mother Nature. She's the one that implemented these systems. And Mother Nature is just the manifestation of Father Thought, law of cause and effect. Father Thought, Mother Manifestation. Think on these things, and you'll start to get a little more information on how this world's worked. So, the Iroquois Indians finally went into citizenship. Alright? They had to be. So, they were made citizens under the subject of the rule of America. But, Mother Nature put them there to mate with the tribes that came over from Israel to populate the Americas, which predominantly were given to the blessing of Jacob to his son Joseph, who ran the prison system and the whole country under second under command to Pharaoh, who represents the male brain, the upper brain, the most high, the invisible thought realm, and Joseph represents the female brain, the manifestation of thought. He had two sons while he was there, ruling under Pharaoh's command. And of course he did get accused falsely and sent to prison. And when he was sent to prison, everybody in the prison submitted to his authority in prison, because he was just a wise man, blessed of Father Thought. But when he got out, he went back up and he ruled the country again. And there was a great famine in the land, so all his family had to come over and bow to him according to the dream. Dream that he had, that he told all his brothers, when all his brothers got mad at him and said, "Yeah, we ain't gonna bow before you." And so they put him in a water hole, left him there, told his dad that an animal killed him, and showed him his coat of many colors that had blood on it, and his dad got sad and cried, knowing that his son probably dead. But slave traders came by and picked Joseph up out of the well, took him to Egypt, sold him as a slave, and the Pharaoh automatically saw that this man was very special. He had wisdom. He had the wisdom. And he was trained up in the way of Egypt. And he was able to interpret dreams and everything, prophesy famines that were coming down the road. He brought law and order. Like I said, Pharaoh put everything under his trust. So, when it come time, when everybody came over to live over in Egypt, all of Israel and his other sons, his 11 sons, all his herds, flocks, concubines, you name it, everything that had to do with the nation called Israel, went over to Egypt to live. And when it came time for Joseph's dad to die, whose name was Jacob, Jacob pulled his 12 sons aside and he gave each one a blessing. And especially he gave a blessing to his son Joseph, two sons. Joseph's two sons' names were Manasseh and Ephraim. Or the other way around, Ephraim and Manasseh. Ephraim was the oldest son. Manasseh was the youngest son. And you can do some YouTube studies. Just type in Ephraim and Manasseh and follow it to the church line blessings. Just equate it with the church. And you'll learn the history of Ephraim and Manasseh, how they became the nation of Great Britain. Ephraim, Great Britain, and America as Manasseh. So, anyway, once Manasseh came over to America, his descendants, through the blessing of his father Jacob, other tribes came over here as well, eventually. So, America is actually a mix of all the 12 tribes of Israel, but predominantly the blessing of ruling this world has fallen between on Manasseh. America has bases all over the world. And it's in combination with his brother Ephraim. Alright? So if you think about it, I just had a Veda thought. It's possible that Great Britain is the father, the invisible side, and America is the female side, which is the manifestation that we see that bears all the arms. And it would seem to make sense to me because it is the violent side. The bearing arms is still the violent side. And America is known as the most proficient in war on the earth. Nobody compares to the military might of the United States. Nobody. Not even Saddam Hussein was a match. But that's just the blessing. Alright? That's just the blessing. And you gotta remember, every country is united under one. It's a new world order. Even China is part of the United States. Think about these things. Now, in the public, it might seem that China and the United States are at odds in some ways. as far as military might goes. But actually, China and the United States are one. Everyone's one. In the private realm. Remember, it's the private realm that rules the public realm. Everything in the public is just for a show. And it has to be that way through fraud, out of necessity, to make the people think, you know, that, everything seems kind of like we're all separated. So, but, yeah, you'll learn these things as you do your studies. But anyway, when Manasseh came over here, the Israelites came over here, they actually took over Indian land, natives to the land. So, now that the Indians have learned commercial law, private maritime law, they also can come in and reclaim their power in united with the nation of Israel. And that's where I come in. I'm from the tribe of the bloodline Judah in Israel. And I'm also from the tribe of the bloodline of the Iroquois Indians. Think about these things. So you know what that makes me? I am, you know what, top dog. And I've always kind of known this, but I've learned it little by little. And I realized that this earth runs by this brain right here. They've been tapping my brain all my life to come up with their ideas of how to run this planet. Because this brain operates fully on fair and square deal meal. And total truth. Now, not a lot of people know this. Everything has been, but it's going to come out. All secrets are coming out. Remember, all the ancient knowledge of the past from the Freemasons, rubbing your philosopher's stones, rubbing your marbles, right? When you polish your stone in the spiritual side of Freemasonry, it's known as the Illuminati. And you're going to have what's called Phoenix Rising. When you study Freemasonry, you'll know that the eagle on the dollar bill is actually supposed to be a phoenix. And you read this in the big blue book called The Secret of All Ages. Big giant book written about 1925 for Manly P. Hall. It give you just a little bit of taste and insights of all the different avenues of how Freemasonry works. And it'll teach you about black magic. How it works also. Just a little taste here and there. There's a all kinds of other books to look into it. But you're looking at the top dog right here. The Iroquois, I call myself the judicial Indian. The judicial Indian. Think about these things. Now an Indian is just another way of saying red man or someone that has an Eastern influence. The female side coming from Ishmael. So Ishmael has united with Isaac. The son of the Sacks, the Saxons, strong arm of the law, Saxon. Remember the rock and roll band Saxon? They're the Saxons. And they wrote a song called The Strong Arm of the Law because they know who they are. They are the enforcers of the earth. They come from the tribe of Israel. They come from Isaac. They come from Sarah. That's why you have the Sarah Bell. Or the cerebrum up top, the most high, and the cerebell down below. The two sons represent that, Sarah. That's why it's called Sarah. So when you think about these things, and who was the husband of Sarah? Abraham. And Abraham was the father of many nations. His name was changed. His name was Abraham, or Abram, and he changed his name. His conscience changed his name. It wasn't this thing called God, invisible guy in the sky with a beard. It was his own conscience, his own wisdom, his own knowledge. He operated from his conscience. All these guys in the Old Testament, Solomon, King David, they all knew about this ancient knowledge of the conscience, the Most High up here. See what I'm saying? But they also knew the condition of mankind coming out of the from the jungle, the kill-or-kill-be world, that they needed to refine themselves. That's why David said, to himself. Now David said this to himself. This is the Most High. David said to himself, I can't do this because I'm a man of blood. I cannot build the temple with the ark. And he said, my son's going to have to do it because he's going to be the one that's going to bring in peace, which is commercial trade amongst the nations, operating through the laws of the universe known as private maritime law. And this whole system's been thought up long, long time ago. And it's finally been implemented, and we've just hit the shift called the Mayan shift. And in fact, private maritime law went public year 2009 on YouTube. And YouTube is the great international encyclopedia of information for the whole earth. Anything you want to know. And everything's coming out. There ain't going to be no more secret. All the bones are coming out of the closet. So get yourselves ready. In fact, everybody's already recorded on the mainframe computers from the satellites above. Everything you've ever done in your life's already on record. So you can't hide. All justice is coming forth, all truth. But you also remember this, not everything under legal codes that people have been nailed for is bad. Just think about these things. And you're going to learn this from Robert Bly. He's a good explainer of these things. But you also learn from me, and of course, the connections that I have. And yes, I have connections. I'm not going to say it right now. But in time, you're gonna see some things happen. And there's one more thing I want to say, but I'm just going to keep it private. But I have spoken it in public. I've put all this in the public ear. I speak it right from my radio program. Everything. Russell Radio 88.8 IM using Tesla radio wave technologies. So, but I figured I just wanted to get this on the record. And I'll probably make this my next YouTube video. But there you have a little bit about the upper brain and the lower brain, the Most High and the flesh. Some call the Most High God, Buddha, Allah, Muhammad, whatever you want to call them, New Ager, whatever, Ekankar, any name you can think of, Tao, Buddhism, any figure you want to look to. And yes, like I said, I am the next figure of the earth. I am the Jesus. I ain't going to die because I understand that claim of lean. Oh, let's get back with the claim of lean a little bit. Like I said, it is a legal code. And it falls under the trust of man. There's two trusts in this world. You either trust in man, which is a nanny, to help you grow. And once you start to grow and you realize, and you're under private maritime law, which is the law of the universe, now you're trusting in yourself. And yourself is just another way of saying the Most High. Some call it God, Buddha, Allah, Muhammad, Ekankar, whatever. Karma, sow what you reap, whatever the name is. So think about these things. Remember, you know, the scripture says that in the New Testament. Think about these things. And remember Apostle Paul. His name used to be Saul. He was a Pharisee of Pharisees from the tribe of Benjamin. He operated from his female side, which is kill all these Christians. Kill them. Impulsive violence. Till he was knocked off his high horse. Who knocked him off his high horse? His conscience. The Most High. He finally saw the light. Boom. Knocked him off his horse. And became blind. And he made his way to another man. And the man said, you know. Now back then, his conscience, the man's conscience was probably so loud it sounded like another voice. Think about this. And he heard a voice. Why hast thou kick against the pricks? And Saul says, Lord, is that you? That was his conscience speaking so loud it seemed like it was real. Same thing with Jesus. When he went and got baptized, he heard it. This is my son, my only begotten son. Da 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 da. His conscience was so loud, I think some other people also heard it too. But Jesus sure enough heard it. And we can actually get into Jesus too, but yeah. I'm starting to see things so much crystal clear. In fact, let's get in a little bit about Jesus. I want to get this on the record. Now, Jesus, the reason why Jesus died, when he died, he died illegally. And I'll tell you how this works. When he was born, he wasn't registered as a Hebrew. He wasn't a citizen of the nation Israel. He was registered in Rome. He was a Roman citizen. So when his own nation killed him, they killed him illegally. And he knew they were going to kill him. In fact, that's where man's brain was at yet. It was to think your own reality wasn't that strong back then. Jesus didn't have it all going on like everybody thinks. He only had enough power to know that he could create his own reality, but yet, and he understood legal codes in a sense, because he went to both the Eastern School and the finest universities in Britain. But he had enough sense to know that although there wasn't a new world order yet, everybody was not under one nation, under all the legal codes that rule this nation called citizenship. Everything was separated back then. And so he was a citizen of Rome. And when his own nation Israel killed him, they killed him illegally. And he knew they were going to kill him, because that's just where his thinking was at. As a man thinks, so is it. I think he wanted to have a little fun with it too. Maybe. But he said, "Once you kill me, I'm going to rise 3 days." The reason he could say that with authority is because he knew he was not an Israeli citizen. And to be killed illegally is not to have any obligation or contract to that nation. So he could rise. And when he did rise, the world wasn't ready to have a man living forever. So he had to go. So he took himself out. Think about these things. Although he had a lot of special powers, man. A lot of special powers. Because he understood contract law. He understood that he was not under contract of a birth certificate and a death certificate and legal codes. Because he was someone else's citizen. So Rome actually represents the higher brain, the most high, the holy of holy, and Israel represents the female brain, the cerebellum, the lower brain, the animal brain. Think about these things. That was a Vader right there, man. Just came right through crystal clear. Revelation. Yeah. So Jesus turned himself back into a spirit. So, since how he understood contract law under legal codes, he knew that sickness had no power over him, nor death. So he knew he couldn't be collected from. But he didn't know fully as far as death went. He didn't know that fully as far as death went. So, in a way, death kind of took him by surprise, but he didn't know enough to know that he didn't have to die. And not only that, he wasn't under the fullness of contract. Because only the fullness of contract under a one world order does a contract become totally full. There's no doubt that there's only one system on the earth. There were two systems back then. So that means no unity, lack of power. Think about those things. Remember, the New Testament always says, think on the high things. Think on the things of the Spirit. Think on these things. That's what it's referring to. So, under the New World Order, everything is citizenship legal codes. Now you know you have authority that no one can collect, but you have to put in a lien because you're under the legal codes of the prison system that Mother Nature put in place. And you can't point your finger and blame anybody for anything that happens to you except yourself and realize that it's Mother Nature who's punishing you, to open up your eyes, to make you be self-peaceful. Think about those things. Self-regulating, without the need of any rules, codes, regulations, local rules, court rules, statutes, you name it. No uniform commercial code, and all that other good stuff. So, I figure I'd just add that little bit, tidbit of information in there too. Seems how we're here. But, figure I'd get that in there. So, yeah. I have total authority to say, okay, no, nothing can collect from me. Not sickness, not illness. And this is all the stuff that you learn in the Holy Roller Churches. And the Holy Roller Churches are nothing but the Illuminati that have infiltrated and taken on the name of the church that went corrupt. Yes, the Illuminati used to be big a long time ago, but like I said, black magic came in and used universal law for the sake of manipulating people and putting them under their control. And then so the Illuminati got persecuted because the black magic side became stronger. So the white magic side of Illuminati, the Illuminati, period blank, is white magic. there's two sides to the Illuminati, black and white. Yeah, that makes more sense. So the white magic side had to go underground, undercover, secret, and infiltrate the black magic side. And so that's what they did. They took on their names. So that's what the whole roller movement's about. You know, they say, name it and claim it. There's a dead giveaway clue right there. You speak it into existence, it will happen. They say, no sickness, no healing. You inherit the blessings. Life. You shall not see death. Life. But they got, you know, the story is a little bit different than what the real truth is. It's a half-truth. But that's all they know. Because you got to realize this too. At least they know something. But there's two sides to it too. There's guys at the top that really know it. And there's guys at the bottom who are just giving the information. But they're still under legal codes. They have no claims of lien. So until they get a claim of lien and actually utilize it fully and full trust and get out for fully from underneath the pain, man, anything. Alright? Operating themselves. And if it comes down to it, manifesting a private ATM card, private bank account. So you can just swipe at the counter and get what you need. And you're not going to get the big chunk at first. You're going to get a little bit at a time. You have to build your credit up. But it's all from the birth certificate application bond, and you will eventually get unlimited. In fact, I already claimed it. Mine's coming. And I got a story on how I did that and how I know it's coming too. Basically, it just goes like this. I gave the churches a lot of money, Jan and Paul Crouch, when they had their telethons. I went in, and they'd have pledge-a-thons. And one of the pledge-a-thons, I gave so much money, and they said, name and claim, your return. And I told them, unlimited amount. And I must have been very special at that time, because when I claimed them in, Mike Murdoch got on the phone, and I knew it because I could hear his voice, and he wanted to confirm it. And he was just dead silent. Just steady, kind of like, you know, what? I said, yeah, I expect an unlimited amount. So I think they'd actually told him who I was. Because the only way to get a limited amount was to put a claim of lien in. But that was like 10, 15 years ago. I didn't know that. And he probably knew about the claim of lien information. But he didn't have the know-abouts how to get done. Or the courage and the boldness to actually do it. Now, the only reason I did it is because I was forced into it because I lost my job in 2008. I got fired because I was trading currencies at night. I stayed up all night one night. I called in sick for the first time in my life. I got fired for it. Just the way it was. The economy was going down anyway, so hours were getting down, and I'd already been let go for a week and brought back, me and another guy, actually the guy that I trained. We were let go, but I was brought back. But I screwed up. I called in, and I told him, I was up all night trading. I don't think it's a good idea for me to come in, so I didn't. So they fired me. So I collected unemployment. But I still had a little bit of money, so I just traded a little bit here and there. But I lost $130,000. I lost everything. I was a good trader. I could trade real good, but I just couldn't wait for the trade. I'd always lose my money. So I lost it all. And it was meant to happen, though. But since I owed the banks $130,000 plus $150,000 for my home, plus another $160,000 for the home I own in Washington State. Yes, I had two houses. I used to live in Washington. I was military man in the Navy for 4 years, 86 to 90. Made an E4 rank. I was an aviation boatsman make. I worked on the flight deck. I tied chains to the flight deck. I drove tractors, and I went down below decks and did 3M maintenance, PQS. And then I went back up tractor driving, and I got out. Honorable discharge, fair square meal deal. I did 4 years of reserve time, but I never got called. I still got my ID card, and I got my pen. I got my DD-214, everything. I'm a military vet. I'm good to go. But and we did a west pack and an east pack, so I got to see both sides of the world. The ship was stationed in Virginia, Norfolk, Virginia, but I got on it when it was in Palma, Spain, doing one of its packs over there. East pack, Indian Ocean east pack. Then we did a west pack. After we came over to Bremerton, we did dry dock. Bremerton, Washington, Naval Shipyard, Puget Sound. So I had a house up there. I lost that house because I didn't have my lien in. I had a security agreement, but I didn't know about the lien. I had heard about it, but I didn't understand it, and it didn't click with me. So I tried to save my house on a security agreement. They saw right through me. No lien. I tried to pay for it with UCC code, some paperwork that I learned on Greg Gentry's site, but they stepped on that too, and I didn't know how to enforce it, so I lost the house. Point blank. But I won this one, and no bank could collect from me. So I was forcing, my point is, I was forcing the situation. I was put here by force. So I took on 12 banks at once. I took on the state of Oregon at the same time, state tax, took on the IRS, and I took on the utility company, and I've taken on the county. I don't pay tax. I'm tax exempt. They cannot collect. That's the power of that lien, and Mother Nature knows that I understand it. So with my thoughts is what I manifest and what comes to me. So I know nothing can collect from me. That includes sickness, illness, harm, anything. I'm not going to die. No death. Especially when I keep my power in my thoughts, I'm going to grow into this even more and more and become stronger and stronger to the point where I'll be able to lay hands on people and they will be able to be healed just like Jesus did. It's going to happen. It's coming down the road. Believe me. Like I said, I am the Jesus returned of the same guy that left 2,000 years ago. I'm just Jesus in another body. Under the new world order now, with a full claim. And the world is now ready to be living forever because technology is up to par with that. And people are looking forward to it. They've been expecting this to happen. But the church, the negative side of the church, I'm not going to call it the false church, because Mother Nature uses both the negative side and the positive side of everything. Duality. Think about that. Think about those things, but to bring balance between the two. But the negative side of the church has always been preaching that you got to go to heaven, you got to die, you got to go to heaven, you're going to go to heaven. But that's other legal codes. That's what they don't understand, fully understand. Okay? And so, and even under that that church side like that, they don't believe in the healing aspect of it. Maybe a little bit here and there, but not as much as the Holy Rollers. John Janet Paul Crouch. Paul Crouch died a couple years ago, by the way. So, bless his heart. Benny Hinn's still alive. He's an Indian. But I still think he's under legal codes. That's why he prophesied there's someone greater coming besides him. And that was me. In fact, he looked me dead square in the eye on a Tacoma Dome, Washington crusade. And he knew, looking back at it. Because when he said, fire on you, everyone in front of me fell down. Not everyone in the platform fell down, but everyone in front of me. We weren't on the platform. We were down the stage below, lined up at the front. But the people in front of me, a big group, probably about 10 people, just fell on the floor right before me. I stayed standing, and I was like looking at him for like 2 seconds, and I looked straight up at Benny Hinn's eyes, and he looked, made locked eyes with me for about 2 seconds, 3 seconds, then turned around, and that was the end of the night. He walked back to the back. But he did give a message. He prophesied this. He says, do what's on your mind now. Do it or you'll never get it done. And I knew what it was I had to do. I had to start a public television program. That's what I did. But you'll read in my YouTube video, if you find my Google page, you'll see the comment that I left on Benny Hinn's page. And it says exactly what I just told you. People fell in front of me. I know who I am. That's why I say Benny Hinn's probably still under legal codes. But I want to help him get out from under them, because I like Benny Hinn and I want him to live forever with us. Think about these things. But this has been an awesome video. I've pretty much said everything I wanted to say that's on my mind, so peace and safety, man. As long as we think it, peace and safety's coming. Healing's coming and everything. Mortgages are going to be canceled. You don't see that come. Mark my words, everybody's mortgages are going to be canceled. And everybody's going to get a house. I am the ruler of the earth under my family. Now think about that. Think long and hard if you can understand. That means I'm prince. And you can just imagine other things that, because I said prince, I don't even have to say it. I'm just going to let the smart ones figure it out. So, I shall talk to you all later. And happy holidays, because every day is a holiday to me. And I even wrote a song. And you can eat, I can't wait for you to see. But get down with your clowns. Talk to you later. Love y'all. All right.